So before I go ahead, something about me. I am a computer science engineer, started my career as a decision scientist. Now I am a data scientist at Gojek. I have a complete experience of 4 years. Things that you can read about me personally. Okay, coming to language model, what exactly is language model? It basically is the probability of a sentence being the correct sentence out of the entire corpus. So what is, you will have sequence of words and you will have sequence of sentences. What is one word or what is one phrase or a sentence which is the most probable sentence that you can form out of a gibberish text data? That's what language model is. If you can see, there are examples on what's more likely to autocomplete. Like, you are attending a PyCon is more likely than you attending an ice cream, right? Similar things like, which is the correct statement? You have multiple jumbled up words, and there can be applications like you have an exam where there are jumbled word questions, and you have to verify what is the correct answer to it. You can build a language model around it. Now, what's the need? So first thing is that we have huge amount of data, the TBs of data and the billions of rows that we're dealing with, that too textual. How do we get insight from the textual data? And that's where language model comes in. If one of the use cases that I talked about is finding the correct sentence. The other could be finding out, so one of the applications where we have used it at Gojek is basically naming the pickup points from the notes data that we have. So these, there are wide applications that you can put this to, but the need comes from the amount of data that we have. That's huge. Few of the applications where language model is currently being used are speech recognition, mobile phones. When you type, it suggests you, is this the app that you're trying to search for? Then machine translation, part of speech tagging, handwriting recognition, and others. Other great examples of language model is, you can see, is Smart Compose and Smart Reply by Gmail. Now here, the language model is over the sentence in a Smart Reply. It will, so Google has managed to create a language model which will suggest to you the entire sentence that should be given as a reply, and not just auto-completing the word or auto-completing the sentence. Similarly is the auto-reply. Of course, we have Siri and OK Google. Now, what is the need? Also, what is the complications of sentences, which makes it a bit complicated to make language model? The one thing is language variability. The other thing is language ambiguity. Now, variability is when you have different ways of saying things. We as humans can understand the intent behind you saying something with your facial expression changing. But when computers have to understand this by just the text, it becomes very, very difficult to put this into context of a language model. Like you can see, these two sentences, where do I go for party tonight, or could you give me a name of the best restaurant, you know, near me. This is essentially the same sentences, but how does a language model or a feature which is based on language model understand that the answer to these should be same? So, probably application could be found out in chatbots. And the other thing that I was talking about which makes language model more complicated is language ambiguity. Ambiguity is one thing that has boggled even people with, like humans, forget computers. So sentences like, look at the dog with one eye, or the chicken is ready to eat. Now these are sentences which you don't know how to basically understand it. Should I keep my eye closed when I'm looking at the dog, or the dog itself has one eye? So imparting this knowledge to a language model is another challenge that you basically have in language model. Now coming to building a statistical language model. So there are different ways, there are basically two ways of overall, if you see, building a language model. One is a statistical language model, the other is neural net. Now this talk is focused on building a statistical language model because it is a basic language model from scratch. Now there are multiple steps which are involved. One is getting the corpus. Corpus is basically the data, the textual data that you're dealing with while building a language model. that's called corpus. The second step is pre-process, which is essentially the heart of language model. Any textual analysis that you do, pre-process is the heart of it. What you do in pre-process is something that I'll explain in the slide. Third step is tokenize, basically getting smaller sequences of words or sentences from the larger ones is tokenized. Fourth is compute probability, probability of occurrence of a particular phrase or a particular sentence. And fourth is generating the phrase that you want to attain out of the language model. Now getting corpus, which is the first step. In Python, obviously, how do you get, so this is an exercise that I've done using US Twitter blog and news data. And so the data is huge. What I have done is taken a sample of data that you can see on the right-hand side, which is taking a random sample of the Twitter blog and the news to come up with few processing steps and the entire language model that I'll present here. But you can choose to later, once you have completely done your entire analysis and built a model, you can choose to do it on the entire data. Pre-process, as I said, is the heart of the language model and also is one of the things which requires the most attention. Now, why am I saying that? Is because pre-processing depends on the kind of application that you have for the language model. If you're working on something which is tweets or which are, say, some social networking exchange of messages. Now, there, the reactions are important. Emojis are important. You should not get rid of them. But if you're working on something which is a book data, might be emojis are not that important. You can get the intent or the reaction or emotions from the text itself. So how do you process the data is very important based on the use case that you're building the language model for. It's a basic tidying up that I have done on the data. Basically, this is something called normalization. Whenever you're dealing with textual data, you would like to get away from anything that can confuse the model. So converting all of them to a lowercase or an uppercase is an intent towards it. So the model should not give any priority to something starting with a capital or ending with a capital. So that's why we convert everything into lowercase. Then getting rid of punctuations, things that you want. So even for punctuations, probably I don't want to remove the contractions. Say I have with an apostrophe is something that I want to keep. Then you can choose to not remove them. That's why you write your custom pre-processing. So this is a custom pre-process function that I've written in Python. And that's how it has cleaned and created this data. Again, so the next step, after you have done the pre-processing based on the use case, the next step comes to tokenize. Now, tokenize is basically to convert the entire sequence, longer sequences of sentences or words into smaller. What I have done here is convert the sentences into words. So each of the word is my token. But you can choose that to have your tokens as a part of the sentence or as smaller sentences as well. So how can you do tokenization? Basically, there is a library, NLTK, Natural Language Toolkit, where you can use functions to tokenize even for pre-processing. But whenever any library has an implementation, it has its own way of dealing with things, which might not deal with your use case. Why I haven't used pre-process from NLTK is because it was not dealing with my use case. So that's why it's easier to write it a custom function for yourself rather than using a library for these smaller functions, functionalities. Now, if you see, I've used NLTK tokenizer on my this left side, and I've used my tokenizer on the other side, with processing and without processing. This is also NLTK tokenizer, but that is with and without processing. Probably I can choose to write my own tokenizer which includes processing. So that's what has happened in the next slide. If you see, I have written my own tokenizer, which is also doing a basic processing which I need for tokenization itself, even if that is not use case dependent. And what is it doing? It's basically splitting the entire phrase into words, into tokens. Now, one of the way of building a language model is n-gram modeling. And we will see what are the different steps which are involved for building an n-gram model. The first step is generating n-grams itself. Second is computing probability. And third is generating phrase. We'll get into each one of them. What are n-grams? So the moment we talk about n-gram modeling, we need to understand what n-grams basically are. So n-grams, you can think of them as individual words. So every word can be called as a unigram. A combination of two words or a sequence of two words can be called bigram. Similarly, sequence of three can be called a trigram. So the example that I gave of a sentence that I pre-processed and tokenized, you can see the unigram being generated from that, bigram, trigram, and quadgram, as well as pentagram. Now the question here is, what is the number of n-grams that I should build for my language model? What should be, should I go till the length of the each sentence, but the sentence length is varying, so what should be my number of n-grams? We'll answer this question as I go ahead in building the n-gram model. So the first thing is to decide on the history that you want your prop. So first thing is building n-grams, then you're finding out the phrases, and finding out the probability of building that phrase from given given unigram or bigram or trigram, whatever you choose as a base. Now, what should be my history? By history, it means what should be your word that you're trying to combine with the base should be dependent on. Should it be bigram, should it be trigram, or should it be quadgram, or anything like that? Now, the answer to this is that it depends actually on the use case. If you have books where you have larger sentences and you're trying to build a language model over it, you can choose to have n-grams till 6-7. Okay, 6 grams or 7 grams. But if you are dealing with tweets or chat messages or things which can be compact, your history can be bigram or trigram. Now this is, how do I generate n-grams? Now that I know what an n-gram is, how do I generate n-gram is this, you can do that using, again, NLTK library. It has a function called n-grams. Which can help you build the n-grams. The tokenizer that you see here is something that I have created. This is a user-defined function. Preprocess is also a user-defined function. I have used just the n-gram function from the NLTK library to show how NLTK would build the n-grams. I have asked for a 1 gram here, and this is the result that NLTK gives. It basically gives it in form of tuples, expecting 2, bigram to be default. You can build an n-gram generator by yourself. What it needs is basically every combination of the words, right? So if you want bigrams, you're combining every word with the every other word in the vocab. You can see this, like I've created a generator for n-gram which will generate n-grams. If I give it 0, it will say that there is no 0 gram possible, so it gives an empty list. 1 gram, it will give you the every single word in that phrase. And this is NLTK tokenizer. This is basically a comparison of my user-defined function with NLTK tokenizer. And the one important thing that I wanted to highlight here is NLTK has built the algorithm based on some use case, which might not be fit for yours. So you will see that if I pass it one, say, a length which is higher than the length of the text itself. This is basically finding out trigram, 4 grams. That's why I'm moving ahead, because of the constraint in time. If I pass it 155, which is way more than the length of any text that this corpus has seen, it basically, NLTK will return a null, an empty list. But I actually custom made it to return the maximum length of the sentence. So that's what is being returned here. second. Okay. There's some resolution error here. So n-gram, the second thing is after generating the n-gram, the second thing is probability computation. Cool, I'll do this like that. So when you do probability computation, this is the main step of the n-gram modeling, right? So if you have a corpus, you start with a bigram, and you want to find out the most probable trigram, or you want to find out the most probable sentence that can define a corpus, or a fraction of the corpus, then this is the part where your model comes. So how do you find out that? The one simple way is to find out the probability. So from your vocabulary, which is the list of all the tokens, you start with some bigrams, which are most frequent bigrams, say. And then to this bigram, you start adding each of the words from the vocabulary and keep seeing the probability of occurrence. So this is the basic approach. You can start looking at the probability of building a trigram from a particular bigram with different tokens, and the one which has the highest probability is the one that you take as a trigram. Now, how do I decide on whether a trigram is the best fit for my corpus or a quadgram or a pentagram? So this is basically covered with finding out the probability of the best probable trigram with best probable quadgram. So as you build your model, you have a trigram being generated from bigrams, you have a quadgram being generated from trigram, and both of them have their own probability. So in the corpus, you can find out if the trigram is more probable or the quadgram is more probable. If the quadgram is more probable, you go ahead with quadgram, and you keep doing it until you find the most probable phrase, which can be a quadgram, pentagram, or anything. Now, the applications that I wanted to generally focus on, which can use the language modeling probability-based language model, are sentence completion, categorization, summarization, and if you look at sentence completion, this is a toy example just to make you understand how sentence completion works. These are the sentences, say five sentences, which is, he said thank you, he said bye as he walked through the door. He went to San Diego has nice weather, it is raining in San Francisco. Now, this is just a toy example, the toy corpus that you have. Now, you want to find out the probability based on just single word history. So what is the probability of, you can very clearly see here that the probability of San Diego is more than San Francisco, right? So, and how do you find the probability? Basically, the approach that I described is for San Diego will be the number of times San Diego has occurred by number of times San has occurred, right? So that's how you find probability basically, and that is with just bigram. Similar thing will occur with trigrams. The number of times the history plus the new word has occurred by the number of times the history has occurred is the probability. So this is more on building the n-gram, generating the n-grams. The second thing, when you're calculating the probability, you'll have to find out the frequency. So how do you find out, because you already have tokenized corpus, right? So you already have all the words that is available. You already have a function which generates n-gram from these tokens. So you have a list of all n-grams possible. Now, the history that I have chosen for myself is 6. So I have all 6 grams, 1 gram, bigram, till 6 grams available. And I basically find out the frequency of all n-grams, run a counter on all the n-grams, and have frequency of all the n-grams, which would include unigram to 6 grams. Now, this is how you build the n-gram modeling. What are the 3 things which are very important when you're building a language model based on n-gram? One that I talked about is probability computation. The other is coverage. And third is obviously the phrase that suits your use case. Probability computation is something that I describe how you will compute. Coverage, why is coverage important in building a language model? Is basically you can have sentences which have very high probability of occurrence, but the coverage, so probability is calculated within the n-gram, right, within the n-gram region. But the coverage of it in the entire corpus can be very low. So you might not like that to be given more weightage because it is not representing the entire population of the corpus. So you can have a threshold around probability and coverage to make your language model more intelligent on that aspect, correct? So because you might have words like, if you're not removing stop words like helping verbs in the English language, is, am, are articles in English language, you might have these sentences to be more frequent and more probable, but their coverage would be low. So you will have a threshold playing on these two aspects.
Sorry, Divya, I'm disturbing you in between. Can you zoom the screen?
I mean, this is the video. You can see it? Resolution is not good enough, but what I'm trying to display here is basically trying to find out the most probable word which will complete the sentence. So I start with I as a token, and from the corpus I am trying to find out which is the next most probable word that can come after I based on the corpus. And you'll see I was is something that it has given along with the probability of occurrence. Similarly, I can ask this, if I give I was, what is the next most probable word to come? And as you'll see, it would be I was a. And this is how you can keep completing your phrase. So this is a bigram generation from a unigram called I, which is I was. Then trigram generation from I was. Then you will see if I give I was a, which is a trigram, what is the most probable quadgram that I can get? And that is, I was a little. So this is all based on the corpus. It has found out that this is the most probable quadgram that you can get. Now, if I give it, I was a little, what is the most probable pentagram that it can form? And that's, I was a little kid. This is the entire sentence that it has found based on the probability computation itself. If I give it some other example, to find out if it can take care of other contractions. So remember I have said that I have not removed contractions. Like I have considered them to be present there and not be removed based on punctuations. So if I ask it, if I have, what is the next most probable word that can complete this phrase, and it says it is I have been. So what I'm trying to tell you here is this is how a normal, without any threshold and without any business use case put into the language model, a normal language model will function. And the efficiency of this will depend more on the corpus. The more the size of the corpus, the better the learning happens because it has better variability to deal with. Now, this is what I've talked about is a basic way you can build a language model. This sets you on for building a language model. I have pointed out that there are multiple nuances, there are multiple intelligence that you have to impart to the language model, and they all are covered under many of these imparting. One of them is, what if you land up at a situation where you have a word that the corpus has never seen? What will you do in that case? So there is something called smoothing, which is used for these purposes. You can read up on these things later, or probably next time I can focus on them. So that's it.
You said that keep in mind two things when you are creating higher grams from the lower grams, right?
Correct.
So there are two things, that is probability computation, and the other thing is coverage. So how do you assign weights to these two things, that which one should have more weight?
What?
Yeah.
So it's more about threshold that I'm talking about here. There is no weight computation that is happening, actually. But once you have one bigram, say, now trigram, you can have multiple, you will have a distribution of probability happening for every word that is being added to this bigram, right?
Right.
So you will understand, so by that distribution of thresholds, you have to figure out the threshold for a bigram and for a trigram. What is that one point where it is cutting the each other, basically cutting the threshold. So it will give you the point where it cuts, the probability distribution cut each other, that is the threshold that you have to put for. And that again depends on the use case.
Okay. Cool.
Hi Divya, so have you ever done any work on context extraction?
I have done my own analysis, not as a part of the
So which course. Libraries, or if you can just suggest any reading, that because I'm doing some work on context extraction,
okay.
And I just need some help.
So I've used MLE, which is maximum likelihood
MLE.
Estimate.
Yeah, MLE, okay.
I've used MLE, and also you can do most of the things, processing, tokenize and everything, you can do by NLTK.
This is fine.
The other is when you're finding out the context, is basically where you can use MLE.
So based MLE, the maximum likelihood estimate is what, it's a concept?
It's actually an algorithm.
Yeah, okay, so it's there in Python, or
yeah,
it's a library?
It's
or
a library.
Oh, okay, MLE.
You have there are multiple libraries which are doing an implementation of MLE.
Okay.
So one is in NLTK itself.
Okay, NLTK, mein
yeah.
And then?
The other is Scikit.
Okay, Scikit-learn, okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Divya, just another
question. Can you
hello. Hi.
We'll send it to the PyCon and they can send it.
Yeah, Divya. One question from my side. So after tokenizing and like creating our model, so what do you suggest for sentiment analysis if you want to perform sentiment analysis on that?
Correct. That's one use case of language model, right? Sentiment analysis. So what I would suggest is you can do with normal n-gram modeling also. But what becomes very important in sentiment analysis is the pre-processing part. That you want to focus on the sentiments, right? So it becomes very important to decode those emoticons. So you can have emoticons which are representing tears. You can have emoticons representing sadness and things like that. If you can pre-process them and convert them into words which can help you get the sentiment out of it, is the basic step of it. And then you can use MLE, as I was talking to her, for contextual analysis and topic classification analysis. What you can use is MLE and TF-IDF. If you want to find out that from a given set of the text that I have multiple sentiments which is going on, but what is the one sentiment which is representative of the entire corpus? So there is something called TF-IDF, which is term frequency, inverse document frequency. You can use that to give you the word which is most representative of this. You can explore this if